Hi everyone, and welcome to this first Grasshopper tutorial for the course Space Frame Structures and Parametric Design. I'm Thomas, and in these tutorials we will look at different ways to construct parametric space frame structures. These videos shall serve you as a basic toolkit on which you can start your own exploration of parametric space frame structures. There are, of course, many ways to build these structures, and we can't look at all of them. But we want to give you this basic input, which you can use and hopefully encourages you to explore your own structures. If you are completely new to Grasshopper, we advise you to look at some basic intro tutorials to Grasshopper, as there will be no basic introduction to Grasshopper in this tutorial. We have these tutorials linked in the description below. So let's start with this tutorial. For the first one, we will look at a method of packing volumes, and out of these build a space frame structure in a way similar to the packing of platonic solids in our Rhino tutorial. For this, we will look at the Conifera project by Mamumani Architects. It is a large-scale 3D printed architectural installation created for Salone del Mobile in Milan. It is made of several hundred interlocking modular volumes, which are 3D printed in a space frame structure. We will, of course, start by opening Grasshopper. And we will start with an empty Rhino file and an empty Grasshopper file. As I said, we will not do a very basic introduction to Grasshopper in this tutorial, but I will lose a few words to the settings I have in mind. I use Grasshopper with the icons on the components, which means that if I place a component, we have this icon as a picture here and not as a text. You can always change this in the display menu up here, where with the checkbox here to draw icons, you will see the components in the same way I do. Another thing I have activated is the draw full names here, which will always draw the full input and output names of the components, which I find easier to use. You can, of course, use it the same way you want to. It won't change anything in the performance of Grasshopper. We can choose the components by selecting them in the panel menu up here, or by double clicking on the canvas and typing the name of our component. We will start by building our basic volume, then move on to substituting it by a space frame structure, and then we will see how we can assemble it into a large scale structure. To have our volumes built in a way that they can interlock with each other, we need to define a grid structure where we fit in these volumes. Our volumes are these flat top pyramids, and we will define them within a box. In this way we can parametrically define different points inside of this box, and therefore can create volumes that we can place within a grid. We will start by creating this box, and for this we can use the command center box. We confirm it and see that we need the base point, a size in x, y and z direction. We will start with the base point, which is at the moment the origin of our file. That's quite alright, but we want to define it, so we type in 0, 0, 0. And therefore define this point in the middle. We want to also define our base plane as the xy plane and have our base here. We will base our size of the box on a grid, which is the side length of the top of our flat top pyramid, and our whole width is 3 times this unit. So we first define the width of our base unit, which is, let's say, 0.5 meters. We want our size in x, y, and z direction to be 3 times this unit. So we use the multiplication component and multiplicate our base unit with this factor and connect it to our x, y, and z inputs. I see we have our Rhino file in millimeters here, so we will change this in unit settings as we will work in meters. So 0.5 meters times 3 is our box, but as we can see, the sizes go in both directions of our origin point. So it's not actually 3 times 0.5, but 6 times. We can easily change this by clicking right-click on the input, and with expression we can define a formula which changes the input value according to what we type in here. So we type in x divided by 2 to get half of this value, do it all of these inputs, and this way our box is now total length, width and height of 1.5 meters. We can see it in the preview on the left. And now we want to define our curves for the pyramid we want to build. We will do this by creating rectangles based somewhere in this box. We can find our base points with the component evaluate box, where we define a point inside of this box based on U, V and W parameters. So we want our first point to be in the middle of the U and V space, but on top of our box. So we have this point here and move it on the maximal value of the Z parameters. And we want the same for our lower rectangle, the bottom of our pyramid. But here, of course, we want the point to be on the bottom of this box. And when we now have our points defined here, we can use them to create rectangles to define the outline of our pyramid. Rectangle is the command we want to go with. We see we need an input plane, which we already get here. This and like this. And we can now define the size in x and y direction. We want to define them as domains, so we don't give a total length, which would go in just one direction from the center point, but we want to go in both directions, to the right and to the left, and therefore we need to construct this domain. We do this with the command construct domain, and we can use the value for our base unit, 0.5 meters, which we want to be our length of our top rectangle. So we connect it to our input for the domain end. The domain start, as it goes in the opposite direction, needs to be the negative value of 0.5, so we know we go against the x direction. And now we again have this length to both sides, so we go to expression again, x divided by 2 and x divided by 2. When we now connect this to, we see the preview of our rectangle here, we can blend this stuff out. We see the preview of our rectangle here, and we can now connect it to x and y sides. So this is the top of our flat top pyramid, and we will now do the same for our bottom rectangle, but of course with the values we get for our whole box. So we connect this here and this here, and now have the correct size for our pyramid. When we now want to build a volume out of these two rectangles, we can use the command loft, which creates a surface between two or more curves. So to keep a clean structure and we know which rectangle is which, we will merge them together. So we know this is our first and this is our second rectangle. And with the result here, we see two rectangles in a list. We can now loft our geometry. And blend out all of this. And we see we created our flat top pyramid. So this is our base geometry which we want to work with. So we will define it clearly as an output here, blend this out, and we can group all this together with Control G. We create our box here. So this is one group, this is one group. Within this one geometry, we will now define the space frame structure. Later, after we placed this basic geometry in all these places we want, we will have nothing but this input of the B-Wrap. So we will have to create our space frame structure based on solely this input. If we take a look at our reference, we see that we have an outer surface and an inner surface scaled within the XY plane. We need to get our curves from which we created this loft to offset them in the XY plane and then loft through them again. As I said, we only have this input. We will ignore everything we did before here. So we have to get the curves of this B-Wrap. We can do this by going to the surface panel here and choosing the component B-Wrap edges. This now gives us the edges of our B-Wrap, the naked one, which means at the end of our B-Wrap, and the interior one, which are adjacent to surfaces on both sides. So we have our naked curves here, which are at the moment split in separate segments. We need them as joint curves, so we choose the component joint curve. And now get two polyline curves right here. For these curves now, we can use the component offset curve to create the offsetted volume of this pyramid. We will connect our curves here, and we want to offset them on the XY plane. So at the moment they are offsetted in a quite large distance. We don't want that. We want, let's say, 0.1 meters. And we see that we offset these both curves in different directions. This means that one curve is defined in one direction, the other is defined in the other direction, and therefore the offset distance to the outside and inside are flipped between these two curves. To get this right, we can use the component flip curve right here, where we can flip a curve or the direction of a curve based on another curve. So basically, we will now choose the first curve with the list item component, which always chooses a specific item of a list, in this case these two curves, based on the index. The index is by default 0, so we choose the first curve and we will flip this first curve. And as a guide, we will use the second curve in this list. We can get it by zooming close to the list item component, and by clicking on this small addition sign, we will automatically get an output for the second index after the inputted index. So we have index 0 as an input here. So the next index is index 1, and therefore our second curve. We will now use this curve as a guide and have both curves defined in the same way. When we take this now, once again, merge our curves together as we only get the flip curve as an output here. So we choose our first curve, again as our first input, and the second curve, which stays the same, as our second input. And we will now connect the result with our offset component. We see they're both offset in the same direction, but unfortunately to the wrong direction. That's not a problem. We will simply get another negative component, which makes the input value negative, and we therefore offset to the opposite direction, connect it with our distance, and now we have this volume offset in the right way. Or more specifically, we have offsetted the construction curves for this volume. We still need to create it, but we will simply do this in the same way we did it before, by lofting it. To make sure they are both built in the same way, we will also loft these curves here. Otherwise, because we flipped one, it could be built differently. So we have built our outer surface. If we move this one, then press Alt, we can copy it while moving. And if we connect our offsetted curves, we should have gotten our volume here, but we see that the two curves are grafted in a list, so they are put in different branches within this tree. We don't need that. We need them both in one list, so we flatten our output here and have created our inner volume. So what we want to do now is we want to connect these two volumes through our space frame structure. For this, we firstly need to define each surface of this polysurface as its own. The component we can use for this is deconstruct bwrap, and this gives us now the faces, so each surface of the bwrap, the edges and vertices as single outputs. So we do this for both these lofts, and the only thing we will need of this are the faces of each geometry. What we want to do now is we want to define a grid within each of these surfaces, which is then connected to the grid on the inner surface. So we could subdivide the surface, but we can also do it in a more clever way, as we can simply define each of these faces as a mesh. A mesh geometry is defined by vertices and how these vertices are connected. So we will use the component mesh surface, which will automatically mesh a surface with a defined count of vertices in u and v direction, which is exactly what we want for our faces. So we will see in a second what this means. When we connect our faces here to this mesh component, we see, and we can print out all of these, we see that each face is built as a mesh with a count of mesh faces in u and v direction. We see when we hover over this output that we have four meshes, which are exactly the four surface faces, this one, this on the back side, and this one on the left, which we gave as an input. We can now define the count of faces we want to have in each direction. Let's say we want 6 faces in v direction. We see how this changes, and some more in u direction. Let's go for 7. So now we have these surfaces defined as a mesh with an equal amount of mesh faces, which are these rectangles, and vertices, which are the points through which these rectangles are defined. We will do the same for our outer surface, or in this case, the inner surface. We have done it for the outer surface here. And we will, of course, use the same count of faces in u and v direction, as we now want to connect these two together. The huge advantage through this method is that both geometries are defined in the same way. They are translated in a mesh in the same way, which means that the faces and the vertices are exactly the same for both geometries. So if we have the first face, for example, here on the outer geometry, the first face is also in the same position in the inner mesh, and the same for the count of vertices, which is of huge advantage, how we will see in a few minutes. To get a space frame structure out of these volumes, we simply need the wireframe of each mesh and the connections between these two meshes. So basically, all we have to do left is to decide which point of each mesh has to be connected with another point of the other mesh. First of all, we need to extract the wireframe of our mesh. We can do this with the command mesh edges, which gives us exactly the edges of the already existing mesh. Also, in the same way as we had it as with bwrap edges, defined as naked edges at the end of the geometry and the interior edges with two faces on each side of the edge. We need all of these lines, so when we use the line component, which is exactly what we need for a space frame structure, as it is a line defined by two points, which is always straight, and not a curve, which could be bent or something. So we have these lines of the naked edges and the interior edges. With shift, we can put it in the same component here. So we have them combined here. And if we want to have it really clean, we have this component and we can call it by right-clicking on it. We can rename it. We will call it mesh wireframe. By clicking on this small bucket, we will write the name of the component inside of this component. So we have our mesh wireframe here, and we can of course do this to the second mesh we have here as well. So we have both our mesh wireframe, and now we need to interweave these two meshes with each other. To do this, we have to choose the vertices of each mesh face, which we want to connect with the other. This is another huge advantage with using meshes. We can simply go to the mesh panel tab right here and use the component deconstruct face. This gives us the corners of each face of the mesh. However, we need to input a face here and not a whole mesh, so we need to deconstruct our mesh first. We input our mesh here. We already see them sorted: vertices, faces, colors, and normals. We need the faces of these four meshes of our outer geometry, and we'll connect them to our deconstruct mesh component. If we turn off the preview here, and what we see here is we don't actually have the vertices of each face here, but the index of each vertex. So to actually get the points, we have to choose the vertices right here by the index we got right here of the faces. So we choose the component list item we already used, and we can now simply connect the index as the index we want to choose for each mesh face, and the list we want to choose from are the vertices of our deconstructed mesh. So this, for example, are all A corners of each face, and the reason we see every point selected here is because, of course, this point is the A corner for this mesh face here, this for this here, this for this here. So we already have chosen the corner A for all of these faces. Now we can do the same with our mesh down here. Choose the faces, and now we see that if I use another list item component here for the corners A, we have these selected right here. And what I meant by the fact that these are constructed in the same way is that we see if we now connect these two faces with a line defined by a start point and an end point, we see that each point is connected with the fitting point on the inside. If we had defined them in a different way, if we hadn't flipped the curve, these points could be somewhere scattered around the mesh. So this is the huge advantage we have by defining this geometry in this way. So we simply need to find the points we want to connect with each other. So we take a close look at the conifera, the example we want to orientate ourselves on, and we see that in fact every vertice is connected with a straight line to the according vertice on the other mesh. So what we need to do is we don't need to select a corner actually in this example, but we can simply connect the vertices of the one mesh with this line component to the vertices of the other mesh. So we have our lines here. We will try to keep our script tidy. So we move this to the right, and we will call it straight connections. So secondly, we see that within each face, the two opposite corners are connected by a diagonal, and on the outer mesh in the opposite direction of the inner mesh. So we have, if we take a look, basically it needs to connect this point with this point for the outer surface or mesh, and for the inner mesh we need to connect this point with this point. So we have our corner A, then our corner B, our corner C, and our corner D. And we now want to connect the corner A with the corner C of each mesh face. So all we have to do is copy our list item components down here and connect our corner C indices with the index right here. And we see, of course, this could be this point or this point, but I'm sure it is this point. And when we now connect these two, we should get a line exactly like this across the mesh face. So what we have here are the curves for our outer mesh surface. For the inner mesh surface, we want to go in the opposite direction, and therefore we need to connect corners B and D of our inner mesh. So we select the index here, B and D, form a line between those two points, and we see we have connected the other remaining two points for the inner mesh with each other. We will once again put our lines in here and label them correctly so we can find them easier. Outer diagonals and the inner diagonals. So the last thing we need to do is, after taking another closer look at the conifera, is to connect each lower corner of the outer mesh with each upper corner of the inner mesh. To do this, we already know the name of the corner down here, which is the corner B of the outer mesh. And let's see where we have the space. We have the corners A, which also works because we only need one of these corners down here. So we will choose these corners again. And now we have to connect them with the according corners of the mesh on the inside, which is the corner D. So we already have the corner D here, corner A here. Basically, all we need to do is connect these two corners. Seems like I was wrong about the corner D on the inside. It's the corner B. So we connect these and now have our connection lines within these geometries. We take them here and label them. And if we choose all of these are our outputs of this whole space frame. So if we blend out all of this, and of course we need to keep a good structure here, so we group them until they are meshes, and then we will group them here to see, okay, here we are working within the mesh. So this is our space frame structure, or at least the wireframe of our to-be-printed space frame structure for one volume. The next step in our definition will be the placement of these volumes in the way we want. For this, we will first place all these volumes in a whole defined area, and then choose which ones we want to keep. So to do this, we will have to define a grid, and then choose at which points of this grid we want to place the volumes. The grid will, of course, be based on this one unit setting we have here, which is the width of our volume up here, because we need to shift the volumes with this unit so they fit to each other. To do this, we will go to the vectors tab here and use the square grid component, and we will start on the XY plane. And for the size of each grid cell, we will use this unit value we defined up here. So we can blend out this plane. We see a preview here, and we can now define the extent of our grid. So we will choose somewhere between 0 and 100. With this smaller sign, we can define the area on which we want to create our number slider, so 1 to 100 for the extent in X and Y direction. Of course, it can't be 0. And we will now see how large we want to go. This seems alright for a first attempt. So we already have our grid here. And our points are sorted. We will see it in rows and in columns. So the points are sorted within these rows. And if we choose the first point of each row, we get this column here. So we want to place this volume at every fifth point. So we want to place, for example, when we go from the edge here, we want to place it at this point. It is 3 points long, then we need one grid square of free space, and then we want to place the next volume. So we need to choose every fifth point of this grid. We can do this by defining a cull pattern. With the cull pattern component, we cull items in a list based on a pattern. So we will delete this, and we will choose the points of this grid as the list we want to cull in. And there are already some patterns right here. By typing this quotation marks, we can create a panel. And within this panel, we can now create our cull pattern. It is defined as a Boolean value, which is true or false, and we can also define these values as numbers. Everything except 0 is true. So everything that is defined as false, so 0, will be culled, and everything that's defined as true, so everything except 0, will be kept. So what we will do, as we want to place it at every fifth position, so we want to place it as true, and then not place it, false, false, false. And then the pattern is repeated, and we start with the one, so we place it again. With shift and enter, we can confirm this. And we need to right click on this panel and disable multi-line data. So every of these values is in each line. Be careful to not have an empty value here by typing another enter. This would destroy the list we need to use. So now enter here, we connect this pattern, and we see in the direction of each list we have culled every 3 points between 2 points. We want to do the same in the other direction. So what we will do now is a component called flip matrix. What this does is we have these points, as we saw already, defined in rows and columns. So we have here these 55 rows like this, 55, because we defined our grid in 55. We see it here when we hover about the output and see the preview of the tree we have. We see at the third place of the branch address that we have 55 of these branches. And within each branch, we have 75 items. So what this flip matrix does, it flips the rows with the columns. So we suddenly, if we flip it here, do not have 55 branches with 75 items, but 75 branches with 56 items, which was already, we have 56 branches here because we start at zero, of course. So, and when we do this, after this one, we do it only with the points we have left. And when we use the cal pattern again, with the same pattern, we see that out of these points, we also cal now in the other direction, the 3 points between the points. So these are the first points where we want to place our geometry. On the same level, if we take another look at the conifera, at the same level are placed the same geometries. We can also to see it a bit better, we will only see it as a solid geometry. We have these geometries but mirrored through the XY plane. So this one is on the bottom and the lower rectangle is on the top. And they are placed between these objects. So we have basically within these 3 times 3 squares are our pyramids. And now at these squares between are the bottom part of the mirrored geometries. So we will use cal pattern of these points, but with a different list, multi-lane data out. And now we want to first leave it empty again, then place our geometry and leave it empty again. So basically what we did here, we can blend out these. So we have these points in this direction. We will flip the matrix again and do the same curl pattern, the same process we did above with the same pattern. And now we have our points defined here. Why these points? When we take a look at these, we are not going from this point here, but from a point of the box. So when we want to place this point, we have to go from a point that is defined by the box. So one unit further to the right. If we think about the center point of the box, we see that it's exactly between the points of the other list. So it does fit. And we can already place our geometry so we see what we did here. So what we need is, by clicking Alt first and then dragging, we can separate the file a bit here and get some place, because we need to mirror this geometry within the XY plane. So here's our mirrored geometry, and we can now place these two geometries according to the grid we have here. Let's see if the pattern we created does actually fit our need. So what we will do is we will create a vector between 2 points. And with this vector, we will now move the geometries from here to the points we selected for them. We need to define this vector between 2 points. One of these points, of course, the end point where we want to go, is the point in the list. And the other point is the origin point, that's why we created it, of our box. Therefore, these vectors start at the center of our box, and all these geometries are also moved from the box's center. This definition through this box is another huge advantage we get if we, for example, had irregular geometries where we couldn't define an equal center point after mirroring. So with this method, we are independent from the actual geometry we created, but can trust that they are moved by the exact same point. So we have our vectors here. The only thing we need is the move component, which is defined by the motion, which is the vector we created here, and the geometry we want to move. So we start with this one, and we see, of course, we now don't start at this edge, but at the midpoint, we have created, or we have placed them according to the points we chose. And if we do the same, vector 2 point to these points here from our origin point here, move with this motion and now with the mirrored geometry, we can blend these out, they're a bit disturbing here, and we see we have our upright geometries and our mirrored geometries perfectly between. However, the next layer of these geometries is not exactly the same, but is basically flipped. We want to place on top of these upright geometries our mirrored geometries, and on top of these mirrored geometries our original geometries. So what we will do is we will basically copy this part down here and this part up here. So we keep in mind this is for the mirror geometries, this is for the upright geometries, and now we will move these points before we create the vector. So we take all these points we want to move and move it up in unit z direction with the height of our volume here. So we have it right here, 0.5 times 3 is the height of our volume. I lost it there. So we connect it and we see, okay, now our chosen points are one layer above. We will do the same with the same vector for these points down here. And now these are the points where we want to move our mirror geometry on the next level, and these are the points for the original geometries for the next level. So basically we can simply put them into this vector as well, because it's the same geometry we want to move. And we see that they are placed on top, and we do the same here, input into the vector, so the points we want to move to, with shift key pressed and connecting the wire, we can add it to this. We now have our next level perfectly on top of the other. So the only thing we need to do now is we want to do this multiple times, and not just the two layers, but let's say 10 or 15 layers. So what we will do is we will move all the points we created multiple times in that direction. So what we will do is we will define the points here. When pressing Control and Shift together, we can rearrange connectors. So we press both keys, and now we can connect the wires from this input to this input. So these are our points. And we do the same for the points up here. Always remember, these point B are all the points where we want to move our geometry. So when we copy them up, we will also move our geometries to more places. We press Control and Shift, reconnect this. And what we will do now is we have these points here and here. We will flatten them and we'll move them upwards multiple times. So we create a series, which is a series of points with a defined step size and a count how often we want to take this step in this number series. So how often do we want to do it? Let's say 5. And we want to move upwards with the height of our box. So our step size is the height, but we don't want to go up one level, but two levels at a time, because we already defined two levels. So we will make an expression here. It's multiplicated by 2. Confirm, and now we will move two levels at a time. This is now our motion in z direction. So we see as an output, we start with 0. So it's the base plane, we stay at the same place. Then we move 3 meters upwards, which means two levels, then 6 meters, 9 meters, and then 12 meters. So we will do this for every point here. We now see, okay, we have these 5 values here, and we have 500 points. And so the first 4 points or 5 points are moved according to our series, but all the other points are then moved by the last value of our series, as we don't have a matching amount of points. So what we will do is we will graph this input for the motion, which will give every value its own branch, and therefore every input value here, every geometry, every point we have, will be moved by every input geometry or input motion here, which is exactly what we want. We already see it. We will do the same thing with the same motion, but with our other geometries here. And if we now connect, so we need to put this to the right a bit. If we now connect our points here to the points we want to place our geometries at, it takes a bit of time, we already get our mirror geometry placed. We see, okay, it seems to fit. And when we connect it here, it will take a bit of time again. We also place our upright geometry. So this is basically all the geometries we can choose from. Now everything we have to do is actually choose, and we will do this based on attractor values. This is, we will measure the distance of each point from a given geometry, and according to a threshold value we define, the points will be, or the geometries will be, selected or not. If you're interested in attractor definitions, we will also link a few tutorials in the description below. So basically, we have our wraps defined here. Can blend all this out and group it as we are constructing our field of geometries here. So now we need to get the distance between these geometries and a given input geometry. So now we blend this out, and we will, as an orientation, keep the grid, for example. Now we can draw the curves on which we want to base our attractor definition. We will just do some basic control point curves, 2 of the count. It's at the moment not really important how you draw them, you can adjust them later. So we want to go a bit up, of course. And this wouldn't necessarily need to be curves, but can also be, for example, surfaces, but we will see this in a few seconds. So now the component we want to use is pull point. What this will do, it will check a geometry, which can be everything, like these curves or surfaces, and from a point, we'll check the closest point on this geometry, give us this closest point and the distance. We will see this in a second. So we have to input our curves into this grasshopper definition. We do this by placing a curve component here, right-clicking it, set multiple curves. Now we can choose in our Rhino viewport which curves we want to connect to this component. So these are then curves within our grasshopper definition, which are live linked if we change these curves here. They also change in our grasshopper definition. We can hide them and only see the grasshopper preview. And we can input these as the geometries that are measured the distance to. And now we need the points from where we want to measure, which are the midpoints of these geometries. We already had them defined here. We could use them, but we also can use another method, which is called bounding box, where we can now put all these geometries together, flatten the input. We can now create a box around the content geometry. So we see these boxes, which are per object, one box around the flat top pyramid. And out of these boxes, we can get our centroid. So with the component volume, we can measure of a closed B-rib. This is important, which is also why we couldn't simply use our B-ribs here, because they aren't closed. We can calculate the volume, which is not important for us, but we can also get the centroid point. So we get our box here, our centroids, according to this box around the geometries. And from these points, we can measure the distance to the curve. If we blend this out again, we now see for every geometry now the point that is closest on its closest curve. And we also get the distance between these two points, the centroids and the closest points on the curve. And based on this distance now, we can choose which points or geometries we want to keep and which not. The method is we will use a tile pattern. Again, we already know it. And as a list, we want to, of course, get our geometries here. So the pattern is already predefined, but not the right pattern, because we want to choose based on the distance to these curves. So when we use a smaller than component, we will check if this distance is smaller than another number we can type in here. So we go with 5 again. And now everything that's smaller will be true and therefore be kept in this list, and everything else will be tiled. So we have our list here, and we see, okay, everything within a distance of 5 is now kept as our geometry. We see that it's a bit too much here, maybe. So we reduce this to, let's say, 2. And now have these packed volumes around the curves we defined. So we see, as we placed these boxes based on the midpoints, we don't really start on the XY plane, but a bit under it. What we can do there is we go back to our input of the grid here, and we will start half, because we started at the centroid, half of a box moved upwards. So we will simply move our input point in unit Z by half the height of a box, and we will now start our plane a bit higher, and we see the boxes now start on the XY plane. So we can blend out all of this. And now we have our selected items right here. We could try more or less of these. Again, we could do it based on X, Y, or Z coordinates. It all depends on your own choices. What I will do here is a component called random reduce, which tiles some of the items in this list based on a random seed. So we put in this list, say we want to tile, we have 300 B-reps, we want to tile 20 of them randomly and see, okay, some are now tiled. We will blend out this, and we now have the B-reps we want to construct as a space frame structure. And we see, if we go to Rhino and show our curves again, if we move these curves, all the boxes are selected based on this updated curves. All we have to do is to create a wireframe out of these geometries. And now we remember we based the wireframe we did before only on this input of the B-ramp. This means we can simply use this output and connect it to the input we already got here. So we will select all of this with Control C and V. We will copy it, set it right behind our definition here. And now we will probably have to change a bit in list management. We will see to that in a second. We can simply connect these two. So what we see here is we get a problem at lofting. This is because we flattened our curves here. And now we have more than two curves. So we have a problem when flattening this. We will copy it down here and let's see how our data structure would look like if we got it out here. So here we have one curve for each branch, but we need, just like here, two curves within each branch. And we see through this offset component, if we compare the address of each branch, we got another level deeper into this branch. So what we need to do now is to get a level back. Therefore, we use the component trim tree, which reduces this data tree by the defined depth of level. So we want to go one level back. We don't want every offsetted curve in a single branch, but we want the two curves we put into in a list together. So the depth, as already defined here, is one. We connect it, and if we now see it here, we see that two curves are in each list. This might seem complicated now. We will take a closer look at data structure in the following tutorials as well. So we connect it here instead of the flattened input, and we see the loft component works again. And now, if we turn the preview on for all of these, we see that each element was constructed in the space frame structure we defined before. With this, our first tutorial comes to an end. We learned how to create space frame structures through connecting mesh vertices out of basic geometry, and we also learned how to fill a space with geometries based on a grid and how to select them based on attractor values. To these geometries, we then could transfer the space frame structure we defined before, and with minor adjustments, managed to create this impressive large-scale space frame structure. This approach offers some exciting possibilities for space frame structures. In the next tutorials, we will look a bit closer at managing Grasshopper list structures to create space frame structures. We hope you enjoyed this video. Leave a like and see you next time.